Thank you, Kerry. And can I just thank Kerry for organising everything today? Thank you.
Thank you.
Lovely. So, welcome everyone. I appreciate you coming. I'm going to run through the slide presentation, which you've got a copy of in your notes. Please feel free to ask any questions as we're going through. There is a microphone that I think Andrea will hold in front of you if you want to ask a question, but we will have a full Q&A at the end. The slides do contain quite a lot of information, and that's quite not so usual, but my very diligent researcher there, Charlotte, does tend to write quite a lot, so I apologise it takes us 4 or 5 days to get through them all. If I see any of you nodding off, I'll just speed the process up a little bit.
I have a copy of those.
You have a copy of those anyway. Yeah, it's in...
Have to take everything down.
Absolutely. No, don't. You don't have to take everything down. Okay, so welcome to the first National Emetophobia Awareness Day. I'm Rob Kelly. I've been a hypnotherapist and psychotherapist for about 25 years and treated every kind of phobia, every kind of nervous disorder, issue, problem, many medical symptoms during that time. About 10 or 12 years ago, while treating things like emetophobia, I realized that the skills that your average psychotherapist, doctor, psychologist had weren't really suitable for treating things like emetophobia, as well as things like ME, post-viral fatigue, that kind of thing. So I started to do some research, and from that we later on developed the Thrive program, which I'll talk to you a little bit about towards the end. This day isn't really about Thrive, though, although the name is obviously everywhere. This really is about promoting some awareness of emetophobia. I did, I think, 17 radio talks yesterday, and already I've had to change the battery on my phone, so already I'm getting emails and messages from people saying, my God, I didn't even know it had a name. That's exactly what I've got. I thought I was the only person in the world that ever suffered from this thing. So already the day's work done its job, I think. So educating and supporting the UK in understanding and overcoming emetophobia. So what is emetophobia? Basically, emetophobia is a pathological fear of being sick. So a pathological fear, it's a terrifying, ongoing, continuous worry, anxiety, just a life-consuming terror of being sick and sometimes seeing others being sick and anything remotely to do with being sick. Sometimes called a specific fear of vomiting or vomitophobia, sometimes called phagophobia, which is really a fear of choking. But of course, emetophobia can go from being a small phobia to a full-blown pathological phobia. The vast majority of people, it is a full-blown pathological phobia. It's terrifying. It's a fate worse than death. So the phobia significantly affects people's lives. So we recently ran a survey, and 61 out of the 62 people that did our survey said that their phobia had a significant interruption in their life. So every day they were doing things differently because of this phobia getting in the way. It's a big thing. Some of the symptoms: anxiety about being sick generally, anxiety and fears about other people being sick, vomiting in front of others, in fact, worrying about dying, preoccupation, excessive self-monitoring, generalized health anxiety. These are just some of the ongoing symptoms that emetophobes have. There are ongoing safety-seeking and avoidance behaviors. So because this fear for the sufferers is so big and so strong, they feel they have to put lots of effort in place. They have to go out of their way to exercise a large amount of control over their lives to avoid this thing. So they do things like avoiding public transport, very careful around food preparation and consumption. Very rarely will they let someone else cook for them. Most don't drink at all. Very high levels of personal hygiene. Avoid people who are unwell. Continually being asked, what do I do when there's norovirus going around my school? Invariably, the parents keep the kids out of school. And you can imagine the furore that creates. Avoiding becoming pregnant or terminating pregnancy. Costa Lambrou, who did a survey, found that 5.3% of their sample had terminated a pregnancy. Even religious people will terminate a pregnancy to avoid morning sickness. Emetophobia does have overlaps and similarities with other disorders. It's quite common, in fact it's very common, that emetophobes have social anxiety. But things like OCD, panic disorder, agoraphobia, general health anxiety, certain types of depression. So I do argue, and I'm sure emetophobia sufferers would also argue, that emetophobia is the worst phobia in the world to have. I've given an example. If you think you have a pathological fear of flying, let's say you have an absolutely terrifying fear of flying and it's all-consuming and it just wrecks your life, it's easy, don't fly. You don't get to go to America, which may or may not be a bad thing, okay? And if you want to go to Australia or New Zealand, you might have to do it via cruise. But that's all it's going to take. It's really not that bad, okay? Two or three times a year, if you're going to fly, if you're going to put up with your fear and you're going to fly, okay, two or three times a year, it's going to cause you some dismay and some disruption for a few days. With emetophobia, and emetophobe can never be more than 99% certain that they won't be ill. So this is something that's with them every single minute of every hour of every day of their life. If you imagine that you had a full-blown pathological fear, I don't mean a dislike of flying, I mean a terrifying fear of flying that brought you into a panic attack. Imagine having that every minute of every hour of every day, and that's what the majority of emetophobes, certainly the ones I've treated, it's that level of anxiety. You can never be 100% sure you're not going to be ill. They will try to be 100% sure by, you know, putting in huge amounts of control and safety-seeking and avoidance behaviours, but you can never be 100% sure. Emetophobes generally have a very strong desire for control. I don't mean they're control freaks, but they have a strong desire for control in their own lives. Even though the chances of being sick are very, very small, that's not enough for them. And the analogy I use for this, I say to people, imagine if I was going to play Russian roulette with you now, and I've got a gun here that's not got six barrels, it's got 100 barrels, and I put one bullet in one of those barrels of that gun and I spin the chamber. Who of you would want to play Russian roulette with me? If you've got a 1 in 100 chance of me killing you dead, you wouldn't want to play, would you? And that would create a tremendous, would you? No. And that would create a tremendous amount of anxiety within you every day. Imagine having that game of Russian roulette every day. Got a 1 in 100 chance of being sick, 1 in 100 chance of blowing your brains out. You can imagine living with that amount of anxiety. So they spend a lot of time worrying about it and attempting to minimize the risk. The prevalence of emetophobia, various studies go from 0.1% to 8.8%. The average across all the studies, somewhere around 5 to 6%, which in a country of about 63 million people suggests that there are probably around 3.5 million sufferers in the UK alone. How many of you have heard of emetophobia before we sent out the press pack? Oh, good on you, well done. One of you has had it, is that correct? Okay, all right. So you think, what, 3.5 million? That, you know, this story is as big a story as any health story we've ever heard of. How come we haven't heard of these 3.5 million people? Sarah will tell you later on, she never told a soul about her emetophobia when she had it, and she's still not told a soul since she's got over it. That's why it's unheard of, and she'll explain that to you a little bit later, which she's looking forward to, by the way. Most sufferers are female. Okay, research suggests that 85 to 97% of our emetophobes are women. In a clinical setting, we find that somewhere between 90 and 95%, almost all, 18 or 19 out of 20 sufferers of emetophobia are women. And that is totally disparate to just about any other phobia. The spread with other phobias usually doesn't go any more than about 60-40. Fear of flying is about 60-40, 60% women, 40% men. Fear of snakes, spiders, this kind of stuff. The split is fairly even. It's not a significant difference. Emetophobia, 95% women, 5% men. This really is a woman's problem. Issue, should I say. Given the relatively high prevalence of emetophobia and its severe impact, it's really important to raise the awareness, hence us all being here today. Research has suggested that many people with emet have aversive experiences of vomiting. Studies have found that individuals develop the fear after a gastrointestinal illness, for example. Another study found that autobiographical memories of vomiting is significantly more distressing than the control group. Now, what that means, it's very similar to a fear of flying in that respect. If you ask someone who's got a fear of flying, how bad is their fear? They might say, oh, it's terrifying. It's 10 out of 10. It's awful. If you say, okay, well, the last time you flew, how bad was it? They say, oh, 2 or 3 out of 10. Their fear is completely disproportionate to their actual memory of flying. That gives you the first insight that this isn't about any reality, but rather about the thinking styles and the beliefs and the experiences of the sufferer. Unpleasant vomiting experiences actually play a very, very small role in the development of the phobia. And the vast majority of emetophobes, certainly that I've treated, don't have a triggering moment. It isn't about an unpleasant experience. It's about the thinking styles and the core beliefs that the person already has. So emetophobia doesn't necessarily cause unhelpful thinking styles and beliefs within the sufferer. They already have those thinking styles and beliefs, and it's those thinking styles and beliefs that cause the emetophobia. Sufferer's beliefs and unhelpful ways of thinking, avoidance behaviours are the major underlying causes. People with emetophobia, people with any phobia, if you think about it, they're not afraid of the phobia itself. They're not afraid of the thing itself. What they're afraid of is the emotions and the anxiety that they create within themselves about it. A person isn't really afraid of flying, for example. Nobody in this room has been in a plane crash. Most of the 12 million Brits that have got a fear of flying haven't been in a plane crash, and yet they have a fear of flying. It doesn't come from an experience. It comes from the way they think about something. But they don't know that. Locus of control could be explained as how powerful a person believes they are, how resourceful and skillful they believe they are at overcoming anything in life. People either believe that they have the skills and the resources internally inside themselves to overcome something. Sometimes this is called self-resilience, sometimes it's called self-efficacy, but it's about believing that I have the skills to overcome this thing. Other people have an external locus of control, which is more perhaps religious, fatalistic, magical, believing in fate and luck and chance and things like this. Emetophobes score very, very highly on an external locus of control scale. They generally are quite fatalistic and external in their thinking and beliefs. And this, again, is one of the major contributing causes to their emetophobia. When we did our research program, when they first started the program, the average score was almost 25 out of 30. So basically, we gave them 30 key areas of their lives and said, do you feel powerful in this area of their life? 25 out of those 30 areas, they said no. They felt powerless in those areas of their lives. The average score for an average score for a non-emetophobe, that is someone who does have some other anxiety going through the program, was only 21. So even someone who has another anxiety or another symptom like depression, generalized anxiety disorder, OCD, they would only score 21 out of 30. So even compared to other anxieties, this is a significant increase in externality and sense of powerlessness. Desire for control is something slightly different to locus of control. Desire for control, when somebody feels completely powerless, they're either going to give in to their sense of powerlessness and just wobble through life, or they're going to think, I don't like this, I'm going to do something about it, and they're going to try and exercise some control. They're going to do something about it. That's desire for control. Emetophobes, generally speaking, have a very strong desire for control. And again, I'm not putting a spin on that. I'm not saying they're control freaks, but calling it something nice. It's not about controlling other people. It's only about controlling their own lives. Okay? So strong desire for control. One research study has demonstrated the link between emetophobia and disgust propensity. Now, disgust propensity really describes why 90 to 95% of sufferers are female. Boys are brought up differently to girls in just about every culture. So when I was a young boy, I was positively encouraged to go out and run around and get dirty and roll around and pick up frogs and spiders and look under stones, and I'm expected to come home dirty every night, okay? Little girls, they're not expected to do that. Also, going to the toilet in public, for example, is normalised for men. Ever since I was 3 years old, we'll take this off the tape perhaps, ever since I was 3 years old, I've had to wee in front of other people, okay? Okay. You might not ever have to do that in your life. So things like urinating, going to the loo, anything to do with bodily fluids, anything to do with how well presented you are, girls have a different upbringing to boys around that. So disgust propensity for women is high. Most men wouldn't think twice about spitting, even into a bin or something if they had to. You only have to walk round after pubs close, and if a man gets caught short, sorry to say, ladies, he's quite likely to have a wee in the bushes. You don't see women doing that, unless you go up north, obviously. Okay? So this is disgust propensity, disgust propensity. The average man, if he had to be sick, would just be sick. He'd just think, oh, I've got to be sick, I feel a bit funny. I'm just gonna nip through a little, I'll be back in 5 minutes. Even women that don't have anxiety or emetophobia think differently about vomiting, about going to the toilet, about hygiene generally, about these things, much differently to men. This is disgust propensity, and that's almost the sole reason why 90 to 95% of sufferers are female, okay? Which adds, if you think about it, to the argument, again, that it's nothing at all to do with being sick. Emetophobia is not about being sick. If it was about being sick, the spread between men and women would be more or less 50-50. Also, the research around people that have had chemotherapy, and obviously are quite often sick with chemotherapy, there's no greater incidence of emetophobia post-chemotherapy. Emetophobia is not about being sick. It's about feeling out of control, it's about feeling powerless, it's about catastrophic and obsessive thinking styles, which we're going to talk about in a minute. Emetophobes demonstrated a significantly high levels of both disgust propensity and disgust sensitivity compared to controls. Women generally have higher levels of disgust propensity, with good reason, which helps to explain the gender bias within emetophobia. Culturally, we know there are different expectations of men and women. Girls are often brought up in a way that encourages them to maintain higher levels of personal hygiene than boys and see many things that boys do as disgusting. I was having a conversation with a professor of psychology recently whose daughter had emetophobia. And he was there, and the wife was there, and the daughter was there. And I said to the wife that when you're out of the room, when your husband's out for an evening with the boys and he's gone for a meal or something, sorry about this, ladies, but if he farts, he will think it's funny. Men think farts are funny. If you marry, those of you that married, test me on this, go and ask your husband tonight. Men think that farting is funny. Women think that farting, as the lady shrugged in the front row, perfectly for me, well-timed, it's disgusting. That's essentially where emetophobia comes from. Men think these things are funny, women think it's disgusting. Most women think it's disgusting. Sensibly, I have to say. Women thus are more likely than men to view being sick as repulsive. Men may be more likely to view vomiting as a joke, even a desire to vomit after heavy drinking. Even women that were treated with bulimia can still have a fear of vomiting. Thinking styles. So there are a number of major thinking styles involved in the creation of emetophobia. Boshin emphasised that catastrophic thinking and hypervigilance, the gastrointestinal cues, played a role in emetophobia. Oh, what was that feeling I just had then? What was that about? Am I going to be ill, or is that? Oh, no, it's just my tea going down. My own work with emetophobes confirmed they do indeed engage in much unhelpful thinking surrounding their fear. David Veal, discussed how safety-seeking and avoidance behaviours will prevent disconfirmation of the threat of vomiting, i.e. there is a confirmation bias. By the fact I'm putting so much effort into avoiding this thing, it must be terrifying, or why would I be avoiding it? Avoidance only confirms the sufferers that vomiting is a terrifying thing. There's been little treatment in the past into research into emetophobia, Veal and Lambrow, clinicians generally regard it as challenging to treat because of the high dropout or poor response to treatment. So David Veal is one of the leaders in CBT in the UK and probably has the only main NHS CBT clinic for emetophobes, so you'll see his name a lot in the research. So he is really the top NHS guy, and this is what he's saying. Clinicians generally regard it as challenging to treat. Emetophobia is difficult to treat through most normal treatment modalities, and there is a high dropout rate and a poor response to treatment. Most people will not finish the treatment program they're on in your normal, typical NHS or psychotherapy, hypnotherapy program, which we're going to discuss in a minute. They also found that 29% of their sample had received some other therapy for their fear, which overall they rated as largely ineffective. There have, however, been a number of case reports of successful use of exposure therapy, and two case studies have described the use of hypnosis. We're talking about two case studies in hypnosis out of 3.5 million, and I think there was four in terms of exposure therapy, so very, very small numbers. The biggest study of its type before our study, which had 62 participants, the biggest study before had only 7 participants. This is how small the previous studies have been. Aside from emetophobia research, the largest published study, I've just said that. Additionally, there's likely to be a reporting bias of successful treatment outcomes within the literature. I mean, if you, 10 years ago, if you successfully treated an emetophobe, you'd write a paper about it. Many emetophobes wouldn't dream of undergoing exposure therapy even in their worst nightmares. So we see lots of people that have been to some of the clinics I've just mentioned. The idea of exposure therapy, the idea of being told to stand there and put that gun to your head and pull the trigger, understandably is ridiculous. And I think anybody that really understood emetophobia would never ever ask anyone to do exposure therapy. The people that have been through exposure therapy, because of their thinking styles, generally speaking, don't feel any better afterwards anyway. They're just grateful that they didn't die. Again, if you had a fear of flying and you gradually exposed yourself to that fear and you trained yourself to think differently and process the experience differently, well, I just had that flight and, you know, it wasn't that bad. I realised I did get through it all right. I didn't die. Maybe a little bit was about my thinking. That person may well get over their fear of flying. Emetophobes don't think that way about exposure therapy. They just think, thank God I nearly died. I won't ever do that again. It just reconfirms their need for avoidance and safety-seeking behaviours. Although people can be helped by CBT or hypnotherapy, generally I've been a hypnotherapist for 25 years. I was pretty good at it. I ran one of the largest hypnotherapy schools in the UK. I treat probably 400 or 500 emetophobes with hypnotherapy, with a special type of hypnotherapy that I developed, and even then it was probably only about 40% successful, and I was the guy that developed it. I think possibly the average success rate with hypnotherapy for something like emetophobia would be well under 10%, and that's coming from a person that runs a hypnotherapy organisation. Many therapies attempt only to address the symptom itself and not the underlying primary limiting belief system. So if it's not actually about being sick, there's no point in trying to treat anything to do with being sick. It's about thinking styles, belief systems. Yet there is hope for the many thousands of emetophobia sufferers out there. So my Thrive program is a highly effective way for emetophobes to permanently overcome their fear. So Thrive, my darling daughter chose that particular verb, who's sitting there. Thrive to grow, to develop vigorously, to be successful, to flourish. I didn't create the Thrive program to treat emetophobia. I created the Thrive program to help a number of issues, one of which was emetophobia. So when people are thriving, they're living their life to the full, they find it easier to be resilient, to stay happy and healthy, to be successful and achieve their goals. People that have that internal locus of control I described to you earlier have a sense of resilience. They don't tend to get depressed, they don't tend to smoke, they don't tend to be overweight, they don't tend to have health issues, they tend to bounce back very easily and very, very quickly from difficulties. They get over things like trauma. People, as loads of research, for example, around sexual abuse and sexual offending. Kids, adults that have an internal locus of control get over it more easily and more effectively. They have better coping skills. They're more resourceful. That's what the Thrive program teaches. So the Thrive program is a revolutionary psychological training program. It equips people with the self-awareness, the in-depth knowledge and skills they need to flourish in life. It's grounded completely in scientific research and many years of clinical experience. Many people suffering from common psychological problems believe that their symptoms are happening to them, and they consequently feel helpless to improve their situation. Let's come back to locus of control again just for a minute. Locus of control is one of the psychological constructs, if you like, that really no other therapy touches upon or describes in any way, shape or form. And it's a really, really simple thing. You either believe that you are doing this thing to yourself, or that it's happening to you. Now that sounds very, very simple, but imagine you're depressed, and imagine you've been told by family, friends that you're depressed because of genetics or because of something in your blood or because of the weather. Imagine you're depressed because of the weather. The moment you believe that your depression is caused by the weather, you're screwed. And you are probably going to be depressed in that weather for the rest of your life. Okay? The moment you realize it's not the weather that's making you depressed, but rather the way you think and respond to the weather, you can stop it. But if you carry on maintaining your external attribution, you will find it very, very difficult to get over that depression, other than by chemical means. That's the essence of emetophobia. If you speak to Sarah, who, as I said, is chomping at the bit to talk to you about her experiences, I'm sure Sarah, I mean, I've never met Sarah before today, by the way, but I'm sure if you ask Sarah what was the turning point in her training to get over emetophobia, she will tell you the moment she realized that she was doing it to herself. Because if you believe it's a fear of vomiting is an external, unpredictable thing. Take a fear of flying. If you're at 35,000 feet and you're having a panic attack, you really believe that that aeroplane, that flight, is making you feel panic. Which, of course, it isn't, in all reality. You are making yourself feel panic. But while you believe it's the aeroplane, there's nothing you can do about it. You're going to have that panic every time you fly for the rest of your life. The moment you realize, oh no, I'm doing this to myself, and you make an internal attribution, then you can change it. That's essentially where locus of control comes in. So thrive, demonstrate, it teaches people to understand their belief systems, for example, their attributions for things, the locus of control. It teaches, particularly the metaphobes, the major thinking style issues that most of them have, things like catastrophic thinking, a certain amount of learned helplessness, obsessing, compulsive thinking, black and white thinking. Black and white thinking is a huge, hugely negative, has a hugely negative effect on people. Black and white thinking, sometimes called dichotic thinking or all or nothing thinking. A lot of people that have a strong desire for control have this black and white thinking, and it serves to kind of protect them from certain situations. So if I say to Andrew, do you want to come to the party on Saturday? And Andrew's got black and white thinking. It's there to protect her. What's it going to be like, Rob? You know, I just want to know what's going to be. Is it going to be great or is it going to be awful? That meal you had, was it wonderful? Oh, it was disgusting. Okay, that guy I met at the weekend, he was fantastic. He was an idiot. That's black and white thinking, dichotic thinking. They see it all way or another way. One of the best pieces of research around black and white thinking was around people that developed ME or post-viral fatigue up to about a year after having glandular fever. So glandular fever is obviously a recognized virus that stays in the system, generally speaking, 5 or 6 weeks. Some people, about 12% of the particular survey that we looked at, 12% of these people took that glandular fever and a year later turned it into full-blown ME, post-viral fatigue, chronic fatigue. Even though the virus has gone 9-10 months before, almost a year later they have full-blown ME. Huge study done around these sufferers. They looked at family history, medical history, they looked at genetic makeup, diet, exercise, everything. And I quote, the biggest indicator of ME, post-chronic fatigue, is did the person have black and white thinking? Because if you think about it for a minute, if you've had a horrible illness, and understandably you don't want it to come back, so I've just got over glandular fever and it was awful, it was ruining my life, and it's gone, I don't want to come back. The first thought I might have every morning when I wake up, even before I open my eyes, is, how do I feel today? And if I feel the slightest bit nauseous, ill, fatigued, depressed, lethargic, I might overreact with my black and white, oh no, it's back again. Which of course we know now creates a lot of anxiety, overproduces adrenaline and cortisone, which are two of the main factors it's believed contribute to things like ME. So the thinking then, and the black and white thinking goes on to maintain the symptoms that the person had 6 or 8 months before. That's just one of the 6 or 7 thinking styles that emetophobes tend to have. That's one of the thinking styles, black and white thinking. The program is, don't get me on it, I'll be talking all day. The program is structured and easy to follow. It's straightforward, it's very understandable. It's delivered via specially designed workbooks, which you're going to get a copy of. If an emetophobe works through this workbook, and which is explained in very, very plain English, no scientific jargon, all of the research is in the back of the book. for people to look through. It's thoroughly backed up by scientific research. I've got, it's free, by the way, it's not free, but there is a money back promise on the book. Anyone that buys the book gets a letter, a personal letter from me sent with it. And I say to them, it's not a kind of money back offer, as in if you're not cured, if you don't like the book and it doesn't help, let me know and I'll give you your money back. So it doesn't have to cost them anything at all. I tell people, it's impossible not to go through this book thoroughly and still have emetophobia at the end of it. I haven't yet met a person that's gone through the book at home by themselves. This isn't touting for business. You know, you can get the book on Kindle for £5 or something. This is £19 or whatever on Amazon. I think it's impossible to go through this program thoroughly and not cure yourself. And I haven't yet met a person that's done that. Okay? That's, I haven't met a person that hasn't yet not cured himself. People can either work through the comprehensive workbook by themselves, or they can phone up and have Skype sessions or face-to-face sessions with one of, she's gone to open the door, one of, we've got about 110 consultants that I've specifically trained in these techniques, about 90 of them in the UK, the rest of them dotted around the world. Sarah is so pleased that she's just bought the company. Sarah is now training to be a Thrive consultant. She's so enamored, just wait till she starts talking. So other training courses and treatments don't go into the same in-depth detail as we do. So what I've done, I've taken our main Thrive program, Charlotte Thrive program book, please. So this is the main Thrive program book here. We've taken this and completely restructured it and orientated specifically towards emetophobia. Thrive trainees, we don't call them clients. It's not therapy. So Thrive is not therapy. When someone comes to see us, if I'm treating Charlotte here for her emetophobia, okay, she's not a client of mine. I'm not taking care of her. I am not helping her. The attitude, the therapist-client relationship is entirely different. It's not a transferential relationship. It's a training program. She is a trainee or she is a student. I'm not doing anything to her. I am giving her a training program, much like if I was a personal trainer. And I told her what she needs to do is run 3 miles tonight and do 20 press-ups. I'm giving her a training program that she does in her own time. She then trains herself out of her own problem, out of her own symptom. That's one of the reasons why once you've overcome your emetophobia by this method, you feel so powerful, because you've done it yourself. It's not, oh, the therapist was fantastic, he changed my life, or the therapist is wonderful, she changed my life. That's actually not true with Thrive. The person does it themselves. They train themselves out of their symptom, out of their problem. Thrive is very, very empowering because it's understandable, it's accessible. My background, I'm not an academic, I haven't done academic psychology. I came from this purely from a psychotherapy and hypnotherapy viewpoint, and how I stumbled across, if you like, accidentally in my clinic one day, the cure for emetophobia and other similar things. Okay, so it doesn't come from you could not discover this program academically. You would not be able to come across it. This is why you will not see it within the NHS or traditional CBT and this kind of thing. So Thrive aims to provide people with evidence they can make a rational argument so they can come to their own reasoned conclusion. So Cara on the end there wouldn't have told Sarah this is what you're doing. She would have said, well, wait up, let's have a look at it. Let's measure your locus of control. Don't take my word for it. Here's a scale that we've created to measure your locus of control. Let's look at it, let's test it. Most emetophobes have very low social anxiety, even though, it's gonna sound a little bit sexist, but you'll understand why. Most emetophobes, as we know, are women. Most emetophobes are actually very pretty and very well presented. They don't overeat. They got high social anxiety. They always look good. These are lovely people who you would assume, sorry, Sarah, you're glad you're okay now, aren't you? You would assume a lovely, intelligent, bright, lovely looking lady like Sarah would have had high self-esteem all her life. I've literally spoken to her for 2 minutes, but I can guarantee that up until about 3 months ago, her self-esteem was on the floor. Tell me that was right.
Yeah.
Good girl. Okay. Her self-esteem would have been incredibly low, not because she's ever done anything to cause low self-esteem in her life, but because if you have emetophobia, you have an external locus of control, a big one. If you have an external locus of control, you feel powerless. Powerlessness and low self-esteem go hand in hand. as does high social anxiety. So high social anxiety, strong perfectionist thinking. Sarah never told a soul that she had emetophobia. Now she's cured, she's only told one person, her ex. And notice that the ex there in there, okay? The reason for that, why people don't tell when they've got it and why it has such a strong impact is because most emetophobes are perfectionists. Therefore, if they are doing anything and creating anything less than perfection, they feel like they're abjectly failing at everything. They would feel like a complete and utter failure. I'm quoting you now, one of the ladies I'm seeing at the moment, who is a wonderful, wonderful person, said to her husband last week, I don't mind if you want to divorce me because of this emetophobia. I'd understand. She feels such a worthless, useless person just because she's got this fear. I'm sure the husband doesn't even know she's got it. He doesn't care very much either way, I'm sure. Would just want to help if he could do. But this is why emetophobes feel so wretched and the self-esteem so low, because they feel like they are completely failing as a parent, as a person, as a human being, as a woman, as a partner, as a girlfriend, all of these things. So Thrive is about empowering people to make necessary changes for themselves. It's the program's effective at helping a wide range of symptoms and conditions, including depression, social anxiety, fears and phobias, panic attacks, eating disorders, self-harm, sleeping problems, chronic fatigue, irritable bowel syndrome, and more. I'm seeing a lovely lady at the moment whose daughter I saw for three sessions two Christmases ago. She had clinical depression. We saw her for three sessions, completely gone. Completely gone, a full-blown clinical depression, completely gone, three sessions. I've just seen the mother for exactly the same thing. We've had four sessions, completely gone. We're going to be writing this up at some point in the near future. And I mean, and I don't mean she's feeling a bit better. When you see Sarah in a minute, and Sarah describes how bad she was and how good she is now, you'll perhaps think what I just said is an almost an unbelievable statement, but you'll see it in front of you in a few minutes, how powerful this program is. Emetophobia is the most common phobia I've been consulted for over the last 20 years. I treated somewhere between 400 and 500 cases with hypnotherapy, analytical hypnotherapy. I must have now treated a similar number, getting on for with the Thrive program, and supervised the treatment of probably 10 or 12,000 others through the therapists within the organization that I run and through the 110 Thrive consultants that I've got. So I only, at the moment in my clinic in Cambridge, where I'm not trying to take on clients at the moment, I'm only treating emetophobes. Cara, who works in London, I would imagine half of her clients are emetophobes.
Slightly less
than half, okay. But that's a lot of people. A lot of people. We don't, you know, there's so many other people concerned for depression, anxieties, weight loss, smoking, all these other things. Half of the clients, slightly less, are consulted for emetophobia. That's how big it is. So I developed this, thank you for that, by the way, I appreciate that. You could have lied. I therefore developed a specific version of my Thrive program to help with emetophobia. Cure your emetophobia and thrive. There we go. Built upon the tools and techniques found in the original Thrive program, but focused specifically on emeto. Thrive program has been highly effective at enabling emetophobes to resolve their fear, as well as make other positive changes. Blah, blah, blah. So we took 62 emetophobes through our program. Four male, 57 female, one unknown. Obviously, I'm not saying the therapist didn't know whether the person sitting in front of them was male or female. I'm saying that it was obviously anonymous, the feedback from the program, so we didn't know. They didn't tick that box. So the average age was 34, and the age range was from 13 to 63 years. Participants have been suffering from their phobia for an average of 23 years, so from 4 to 55 years. A comparison group of 50 other people that consulted us for various other issues, their mean age was 37, and this group included 34 women and 16 men. Most, 85% of the emetophobic participants had use of a Thrive consultant to help them, whether that was anything from just a couple of sessions to the full course. The full course, by the way, from scratch, is only 6 hours. That's a full course. The mean number of sessions they undertook was 7. Sorry, I lied, 7 hours. 9 participants undertook the Thrive program, mostly by reading the workbook at home by themselves, although some had additionally seen a Thrive consultant for a single session. Most of the comparison group also visited a consultant. Three of the comparison group had undertaken the program solely by reading the book. Participants stated the severity of their symptoms before and after completing the program on a 4-point scale. Almost all, nearly 100%, emetophobic respondents rated their phobia as having a severe impact upon their lives, with the remaining participant rating the phobia as significant. A severe impact upon their lives. The emetophobic participants also completed a new measure of symptom severity. There wasn't one out there, so we developed one. Higher scores represented greater severity. Participants scored an average of 25, nearly 26, oh sorry, 25 out of 30 in our emetophobia severity scale. And all the potential areas of their lives that it was affected. I think you got a full copy of our research survey in your handout. The finding that emetophobia severely impacted upon the participants' lives was consistent with the results of other studies. Lipsitz found that over 90% of respondents said they experienced distress from emetophobia 52 weeks a year. Over 70% said they were distressed 6 to 7 days a week. 3.5 million people, mostly women, going through this every day. So our study explored the emetophobic participants' response to going through our Thrive programme. After finishing the programme, the majority, just under 90% of the emetophobic participants, rated their symptoms as having little or no impact anymore. That's our lowest thing on our scale, little or no impact. The remaining 7 rated them having modest impact. That was the next step up out of 4. All participants therefore reported substantial improvements in their condition. Significant improvements were also seen in the participants' ESS scores. Average before was 24, the average after was 5.51. And if you think that a couple of those questions are things like, I would really still rather not like to be sick. Well, everyone in the room would tick that box, wouldn't they? A statistical test found this to be a significant difference. Anyone interested in statistics? Jana? Okay, read it afterwards. I'll give you the paper afterwards. This demonstrates the statistical significance of the difference between the before and after scores. Locus control, self-esteem and social anxiety scores. The emetophobic participants were also compared before and after the programme. Again, statistical tests suggested significant improvements. The locus of control score, remember we talked about that, was 24.5 before, came down to just 5 after. So these, ostensibly mainly ladies, not only got over their phobia, but those that beforehand felt powerless in 25 out of 30 areas of their life, that dropped down to just 5 areas of their life. That's a huge increase. And the social anxiety, the mean score before was 16.5, that was out of 20, dropped down to 3.6. So the social anxiety levels came right down. The self-esteem levels went right up. That is why they got over emetophobia. That is why Sarah got over emetophobia, because she created a more internal locus of control. She created high self-esteem and got over her low social anxiety. Sorry, she created high self-esteem and she reduced her high social anxiety down to very low social anxiety, which I say is why she's incredibly happy to stand up and talk and dance and sing for you today.
I get her to sing.
Thrive Programme is a highly successful treatment for emetophobia. An approach addressing people's limiting beliefs and unhelpful thinking styles leads to substantial reduction in symptoms. Continued research into the Thrive Programme is planned and ongoing. Fabulous. Can we have the lights up, please? Thank you. Okay, so we need the microphone. Is that all right? They're just there, on that chair on the end there. Are there any questions, ladies, before I ask, or gentlemen, sorry, Tony? Yes.
You say you check before and after.
Yes.
How long afterwards did you check, and did you go back at some stage after you're in?
The participants on that first survey, the 62 participant survey, they could go online any time after they'd finished the programme. Did we know an average?
No, we didn't actually take that.
No, we didn't take that detail. No.
So what I'm trying to say is, does it last?
Well, we've had no feedback from anyone to say that it hasn't.
Okay.
And we are in contact with most of the emetophobes that have been through the programme with consultants prior. All the research around locus of control strongly suggests that once you've changed the locus of control, that stays changed. Tony.
Yeah, one of the questions I've got is with reference to your view on support forums. So okay. When people go online and maybe in search of looking for other people that have got the same problem, and when they talk about that problem, i.e. emetophobia,
okay.
Just your view and whether you think that's a helpful thing or not a helpful thing.
Okay, that's actually a really good question. One of the issues, we're seeing a lot of children and teenagers with emetophobia. If we're treating children or teenagers with emetophobia, we always get mum in as well. Or dad. We always get mum in as well. A lot of the thinking styles that emetophobes have are just copied from their parents. Okay? So you can almost guarantee that if someone's got emetophobia, for example, then mum or dad was probably a little bit obsessive. Or mum or dad was probably quite catastrophic in their thinking. If the child or the sufferer has an external locus of control, it's quite likely one or both of the parents did as well. Now, as an adult, that doesn't matter because you're probably not still living with your parents. But if you imagine we're treating a 16-year-old girl from emetophobia and she's still living in the environment where there is lots of externality and mum's very obsessive and very fussy about germs, etc., it's very, very difficult to treat. The reason to mention that is because generally speaking, health support forums are set up and run by people that haven't been cured. When you're cured of something, you're not interested in running a support forum anymore. So actually, going on support forums, I think that is incredibly unhelpful for emetophobes, because generally speaking, I think it was something in the news a couple of years ago, wasn't there, about anorexics going online to learn more about how to be anorexic. All you learn from an emetophobia support forum is how to be more skilled at avoiding being sick, which actually is completely the wrong direction you want a person to go in order to get better. So one of the reasons we set up an emetophobia website with just scientific information and research papers on is just for that. It's for that reason alone, to get people away from getting people that will collude with your beliefs about emetophobia and just present... just present some scientific evidence about how to get over your emetophobia. Right, before we... Yes. Oh, there's lots more. Good.
Just so that the cameras can pick up the lovely...
Hello. Rob, am I right in thinking... So this is... Thrive is CBT at its heart, isn't it?
Oh, God, that hurt. Anyone see that?
Sorry.
I the nearest thing would be CBT, but it is a million miles away. And I'll tell you why it's a million miles away, since that was your next question. CBT, generally speaking, and I'm speaking about people who have been through it that then come to us, this isn't necessarily my personal opinion. People's experiences of CBT, particularly for emetophobia, is that because the therapist themselves or the consultant, the psychologist, didn't really understand emetophobia, they couldn't tailor the sessions that the sufferer had specifically to it. So what you'd get, if I'm being completely honest, because of the lack of understanding about emetophobia, generally speaking, the therapists do entirely the wrong things. Like, you're told to keep a list of all the times you think about being sick. And you're asked to keep a list or a diary every time you have avoidance-seeking or safety-seeking behaviours, which is, again, absolutely the wrong thing to do. So CBT comes from the general medical stance of where they don't take into account that it's not an external thing, it's not a real thing that's happening to you. The person is creating themselves, and they don't aim to cure it, they aim to get the person to be able to live with it. So the only other book on emetophobia, for example, on Amazon, it's How to Live with Your Emetophobia. So the whole attitude towards it within the NHS is different. It's about managing it while still having it. I don't know that they even recognise it's possible to get over it. And also, generally speaking, psychology doesn't have the knowledge of emetophobia necessary to get someone over it. We were at the Scottish Learning Festival last year, and the chief psychologist from Scotland was talking to us about his daughter who's got it. He said he'd never even treated it. He didn't even know it had a name. Now, I'm sure in a few years' time, hopefully starting from today with awareness, they will get a better idea of it and get some specific training in it. But as of yet, and I work with two CBT specialists in Cambridge, neither of those two would be able to help someone with CBT.
But, so thank you for that. So what you're saying is, I mean, this is the first time that learning how to look at your thought patterns and belief systems, this is the first time that looking at that has been used to treat emetophobia.
Yes,
would that be roughly right?
Put in a way that's accessible. If you think again about the high levels of social anxiety, I mean, the quote from David Veal was, there's a high dropout rate. Now, you only drop out of something you don't believe is going to be effective. Our original Thrive program was called Changing Limiting Beliefs, the original program. It's far more concerned with the beliefs that the person has than thinking styles. And of course, generally speaking, CBT doesn't necessarily address beliefs. But you've got to get this information across to a person in a way that they're not going to feel judged, that it's going to make sense to them that they will do it. The negativity and the learned helplessness is so much that they already don't believe it's going to help. They've had it for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Got a lady, got an email I talked about on radio yesterday. She's 80, she's had it since she's 8 years old. If you said, oh yeah, we've got a program, this will help you, her first response, like the 15 million obese adults in the UK, is gonna be, that's not gonna help, I've tried it, yeah, done that, tried it. So it has to be something that is believable right from day one. By the time you're 5 pages into this book, if you've got emetophobia, you think, my God, this is different. This might actually work. And that's what keeps people in the program.
That is something that I wanted to ask you about. How long do people have to stick with this program? You talked about, I think, 7 courses before they see some results. And from your research, what would be the main triggers? I mean, do they occur in childhood or early teenage years with these girls, with these females?
Okay, 2 questions. First question is, the average person using the book at home does it in about 4 to 6 weeks. So it's a 4 to 6 week program. When they consult one of our consultants, the program itself is ostensibly a 6-session, 1 hour a week for 6 weeks. That's what the program is designed to be. As you saw, the average on here was 7. Well, that's not surprising for emetophobia, but it is a 6-session program. When they do it at home, it's laid out over 4 to 6 weeks. So basically, most of the book, they are learning about themselves. There's always one. Most of the book they're learning, and then you've got to do it. You've got to get in the habit of thinking differently. If you think about positive thinking, what happens, generally speaking, with CBT, particularly for emetophobia and things like ME post-viral fatigue, is you start to do something, you feel a little bit better, and then you stop doing it. And then, of course, a few days later, you dip back down again. And think, oh, shit, I'm feeling bad again. I'll go back to it again. That's not long enough. You have got to create a new habit. You've got to create a new habitual way of thinking and acting. That takes about 4 to 6 weeks. So most of us in this room are probably right-handed, yeah? Good, thank you, right? Which means we eat with our knife in our right hand and our fork in our left, and we've done that all our lives, 3 meals a day. It would only take you about 3 weeks to completely change your handedness in relation to eating and you to feel that it's the most natural thing in the world. Now, you wouldn't think that. You think, oh, my God, I've been doing that way for years. It'd take me months, if not years, to change it. That's just what you would think. But actually, the research doesn't suggest that at all. 2 to 3 weeks to change that habit. So one of the reasons why this is successful, and generally Thrive is successful, we absolutely drum it into the trainees that you've got to be putting in effort every day. Every single day, you've got to be doing something to change your thinking and your beliefs. If you don't, you'll go back. You'll fall down well. You'll hit a little bit of a blip, and you'll go downhill a little bit. And we explain that in the book, and we explain why that will happen. And of course, with emetophobes, the moment they start perceiving that they're failing, they then start to beat themselves up. So this little blip becomes 3 days of feeling absolutely terrible and shit.
Rob, so does that mean you have to sit down with the program for a period of time every day while this is going on to kind of train you back in
a
way?
No. You have to read and study that much of the book. That's the background information. Okay? And you can do that over whatever period you want. It's really the last chapter says, right, now you've learned what you need to know, now you want to put it into practice. And you can either do that with the book, or most of the techniques that we've developed on there are very, very simple. You just make a couple of notes a day, it's on your iPhone, processing positives, seeing things differently, challenging some of the beliefs you have, recognizing when you're doing your safety-seeking behaviors and challenging them, recognizing the fallacy of obsessing about something, this kind of stuff. So once they've learned what they need to do, from that moment, it's usually about a 4-week process, and they need to put effort in every day, maybe 20 minutes a day. You know, if you were to consolidate that 20 minutes a day. What was your second question? Because that was a good question.
Are there triggers in childhood and
teenagers? I think I meant to put that in there. I think even calling them triggers for emetophobia is unhelpful. No, it's great, because most people do. We, as therapists, we call them triggers, okay? It's actually unhelpful, because even to suggest that the triggers are somehow significant, again, is external, isn't it? Yeah? A lot of emetophobes that we treat don't even ever remember being sick. Most have not been sick for years. Some report never ever within memory of being sick. So the only likely trigger, if there was one, would be being sick. It's not about triggers. Looking externally for a reason why someone has emetophobia is a little bit unhelpful. It's all about the person's belief systems, thinking styles, cognitive ways of processing things, how obsessive they are, how catastrophic it's all. It's not about external things at all. You can have people that have emetophobia that have never even been sick. Back of her neck. Yes.
You probably know.
But if you.
So that's what I thought.
Okay. But if you think about it though, if you've got any issue at all, let's say you've got a fear of snails, okay, and you've had that fear of snails for 40 years, and you're deeply obsessive, you spent most of your life looking back trying a reason for your fear of snails. You've remembered every interaction you've ever had with snails, every time you've seen them on telly. And of course, when you look back and think about that time you saw Johnny Morris on telly with a snail who had a panic attack, bearing in mind you've got a strong degree of control, you're going to say, well, that's a logical... That's when it all really started back then. That's probably not true.
It's when I trod on one in the rain.
There you go. When you trod on one in the rain, which is reason enough to have a fear of snails. But triggers are, particularly the emetophobes, they're unhelpful only because they so badly want it to be an external thing. Well, there you go. It's obvious, isn't it? I was talking on radio yesterday, talking to one reporter, and he's saying, well, Rob, it is really awful being sick, isn't it? And I said, no, it's not. That's a really unhelpful thing to say on bloody radio to 3 million people. It's not really awful. It's a little bit unpleasant for 10 minutes. Sorry, you had a question?
Yeah.
It's on. Don't press the button, because that mutes it, apparently.
Definitely on. I'm here taking photographs today, but I'm also a mother of what I have recently identified as a child suffering from vomit phobia. I can't say the big word. First off, I know that for Sarah to even be here, that must be amazing, because my daughter wouldn't be able to sit in the room and hear the word vomit or say it.
She hasn't got emetophobia anymore.
Exactly. So I know that that's an example in itself, so that's amazing. Secondly, I think that if my daughter's 10, and I noticed in some of the reading that I did before I came here that I think the average onset was something like 9 and 3 months or something, and when you did the blurb there, your research, it started at 14, I think, within your group. So even those children had been suffering for 3 or 4 years, and to think that you and lots of other people are suffering for many, many years breaks my heart, because I know how debilitating it is and how it affects so many parts of a child's life, family, parents, etc., etc. I also, interestingly enough, am a very positive thinking person and very understanding about what mind is. So it was interesting when you said about the parents that you said they're often that type of person that deals thinking it's an external thing, whereas I know about sort of placing your thoughts in the right place, blah, blah, blah. So my question comes to the fact that at 9 years old, obviously with the help of a parent, how able and capable do you feel a young child is of constantly checking themselves to pop their brain and their thought patterns in that positive thought pattern rather than that, so making it more internal than external, which is what you were talking about?
Actually, good question. Actually, much easier. That's why we train the parents. So I only have, for example, if I was treating your daughter, I'd have an hour a week with her. You have 40 hours a week with her. So I teach you to teach her. So the 4 hours a night you're with her, you can pick her up on some of the thinking styles. The thinking styles for that age of child aren't as crucial as the fundamental underlying beliefs, which are easier for you to address with her. For example, actually positivity, as you mentioned it, positivity actually isn't necessarily that helpful with something like this. Because inadvertently, a parent is always going to collude with their child. Unless you're saying exactly the right things. For example, if my wife comes home and says, oh, I'm really depressed, I've had an awful day at work. I should say ex-wife comes home and says something like that. It's very difficult, not because you love them, not to be colluding. If you say, oh, darling, come on in, make you a cup of tea. You are agreeing unconsciously that work is the cause of her stress. So you're colluding with her untrue belief that work caused her stress. A far better response would be, come on in, I'll make you a cup of tea. Remember, though, it's not work that causes the stress. You're causing the stress yourself, but love you to bits. Let's have a cup of tea, and I'll see if I can't help you out of it. I know. I did say she was an ex-wife, didn't I? So actually, this book is being launched today, and it is a difficult area, okay? This book's been launched today. We've had a trial book going for about 2 years. I've just rewritten quite a big section on how not to collude, particularly with your daughter. And once you've learned, it's only four pages, once you've learned that book, it's quite easy to train them out of it. It doesn't take long to train them out of the beliefs. The thinking styles stem from the beliefs. Change the beliefs, the thinking styles stop. For example, there's a fantastic graph in there of the amount of obsessing someone does is directly related to how in or out of control they feel about a situation. So we only obsess about a situation we feel out of control in. We only get stressed about a situation we feel out of control in. When the beliefs reduce down to a more helpful level, the thinking styles should disappear. Why does everyone feel better on holiday? Because they're not brooding about stuff. They're not getting stressed about stuff. So it's about managing your thinking. But I'm certainly happy to have a chat with you about it. But if you read the book and you worked through the book yourself so you knew it, you could then teach your daughter much more easily than I could. That's why we get the parents in. Shall we hear Sarah? Da-da-da. Round of applause for Sarah. I think she probably needs a microphone, Kerry.
Oh, yeah.
Is that on?
Hello?
Oh, it is on. So, Kerry, I don't want to put you on the spot too much, but can you just say a little? Well, just say a little bit. How bad was it? What was the hardest thing in the program? What was the easiest thing in the program? That kind of stuff. Just for a couple of minutes.
Same as your daughter. Hi, everyone. I was about 9 when the symptoms started. It would be panic attacks, just totally distressed, crying if ever I felt sick or was sick. At 15, I was misdiagnosed with an eating disorder because it got to a point where I wouldn't eat anything through fear of being sick. Saw a psychiatrist. And it just, the phobia just controlled every part of my life, to where I ate, would avoid restaurants. You know, if I did eat out, everything had to be cremated before I'd go near the food. Seafood was a food I always would avoid. Holidays, would always take short flights somewhere because just so I could get somewhere quick through fear that someone might be ill on the plane or I would be ill, because being in that confined space, I think sort of made the fear even bigger. And probably the most damaging, I think, the most sad thing is that... is that it stopped me having children as well, because I was just so scared of having morning sickness. I'm now sort of late 30s, so that's really impacted my life, relationships. Just avoided any point that I could get pregnant, which is, looking back now, is really sad, but I still found a way of justifying that I will have the phobia forever and I'll just have to deal with it and maybe never have children. Anyway, I just want to share that story with you, but I met Cara last year in October and had 5 sessions with her. And it sounds cheesy, but it has completely changed my life. And to be sat here today talking about my story is just incredible. As Rob has said, most people with the phobia, you never feel you'll ever overcome it. So you just find ways of how to adapt your life to just deal with it on a daily basis. But you just kid yourself that, you know, I'll be okay, but it's always there. It's always on your shoulder. So I had the 5 sessions, and since then I've been around people that have been sick and have stayed under control, haven't had any kind of panic symptoms. I've been sick myself as well, and I've dealt with that fine, and afterwards just think, what was that all about? Because it's more with this phobia, it's more about the anticipation as well, the build-up to the actual moment that it happens. So all that anticipation has gone now. I don't use hand gel anywhere like I used to. I'm not just sat on the tube or public transport checking for people that they might be ill. Before, if there was a bug going around or someone was ill in the family, I'd do anything to avoid it. But I learned over the years how to be very clever with it, to not show the fear immensely, because I just felt embarrassed and ashamed, really, and it's just a secret.
Did you?
Secret
so,
taboo subject.
Did you tell anybody when you had it?
No.
Nobody?
Nobody. At the age of 15, when I was diagnosed with this eating disorder, my mum and dad knew there was issue around being sick, but nobody just really understood it. Even the physicians and that I was seeing didn't really get it. They just thought there was other problems within the family that needed to be addressed.
And you wouldn't talk about it to your best girlfriend because?
No, just absolute embarrassment that if I was to be ill, they'd look down on me. Again, what Rob was describing earlier, it's that being a lady, it's being a girl, that you can't be seen to be ill. So any time I was sick, which has been quite rare throughout my life, really, because of trying to avoid it, I'd always be in that bathroom my own. Wouldn't want people to see it happening to me.
OK. So, and even though you're over it now, you've still only told one person?
Yes.
Why only one now?
It was just, I think, because I've gone through the programme so recently, I wanted... It's just been such a massive secret my whole life to just how to say that to somebody. I don't want to use the word difficult, but I just didn't know how to go about it. So even had a couple of drinks and blurted it out, and then thought their reaction was, oh, okay, never even heard of it. But I was expecting a reaction of, you know, you must have been a weirdo, you're just some mad woman. Why would you be suffering with that? So now I've told one person, I feel good that I can now tell more, which is why I'm telling you all as well.
Doesn't mean you still won't get that reaction, though, to be fair, possibly. But this, so I genuinely have not met Sarah before today. I would say Sarah isn't particularly high on the scale either of severity and presenting symptoms. You know, Sarah would be slightly under average in severity in the past. I mean, as this lovely Camilla, I didn't get your name, sorry. As Sue said, you know, when I first did the book, I got complaints for even having the word vomit in the book. Some emetophobes can't even read the word vomit.
Yeah, I felt the same, Rob. Just seeing...
Don't try and big it up now. You had your chance a minute ago to big it up. But it's terrifying, isn't it? Even seeing the word is enough to create anxiety. Can I ask you, I did allude to it earlier, you can disagree, you don't have to agree with me on that. What was the turning point? If you had to pick one part of the programme that you think, right, that was the moment I really thought, yes, what would that be?
When I was sick myself.
Okay.
Or the moment before I was sick. That was probably the crucial part of it. There was no anxiety there. It was just not feeling great, could be sick, but didn't sort of brood on it and dwell on it for ages. So that was probably the massive turning point. And being near my sister as well when she was sick back in December on a heavy night out.
Do you know you've done your locus of control scores and things afterwards? Do you know what your locus of control scores come down to?
Probably was about five.
About five, yeah. And obviously the self-esteem's gone up.
Yes, and that was another turning point as well, was processing the positives every day. And although my family knew I was working on a book, they didn't know what it was specifically about. Everybody said, "Sarah, what are you doing that's so different? You just seem different. You seem more confident, more relaxed, just daily about life, not feeling I'm having to..." I wouldn't say I was a controlling person, but would like to take control to a certain extent, feeling I'm having to sort of look after everybody. But that's just eased off so much that people notice that. So the self-esteem was a big thing for me.
Thank you very much. Can you just explain what you mean, you've just said now, by processing the positives every day? What do you mean by that?
Just anything on a daily basis that... if someone's been nice to me or if something I've done for somebody else, just the small things that I think, I think all of us would not realise that we've done or have missed. And that's been a massive thing that I have on my phone and I still do now. Just noticing a lot more, yeah. And also when I was going through the programme, I'd process times when I'd been in a situation where I was near a boy that was sick after I'd had a session with Cara. He was sick in this bag, and I just walked straight towards him. Now, I would never, ever have done that. So, to me, that was processing a positive that, OK, I dealt with that, OK, that was after, I think, the second or third session. And I felt great afterwards. In fact, I went up the steps and then walked back down and walked past him again. Just to...
One of the things we recognised when we were putting the programme together was that self-esteem is something that's very, very recent. Most people think their self-esteem comes from experiences throughout their lives. We found that self-esteem actually is very rarely more than about 2 weeks old. So we created a technique within the program called processing the positives, which you add to your phone. So we teach people to recognize that they're behaving differently and they're learning new skills, and not just to let that go past them, actually stand back and say, "Do you know why I did that? I actually just stood there when this person was vomiting. I am getting over this thing. I am building my self-esteem." Kind of a pat on the back, but it is a specific technique within the programme that we get everybody to do, and that they make a list of these recent things on their phone so they can keep reminding themselves of these ways, the different ways in which they're learning new stuff. Thank you. Can I ask Cara? Cara, what would, taking Sarah through, what would you have said the hardest part or the most difficult part as you training Sarah? What might have that been? Or was she just... lovely all the way through?
She was lovely all the way through. From Sarah's own feedback, the hardest part of her was the perfectionist thinking and believing that she had to get everything just right. So there was a particular session, I think it was after session two, and we talked about locus of control, and I expected her to come in feeling all buoyed up, thinking, you know, I can really do this now. And what she hadn't let on to me was that she felt so overwhelmed with the thoughts of, I can't do this, you know, and I'm not good enough, and I'm not going to be able to get over this. And so that was quite a blip for her. And we talked about the perfectionist thinking, she doesn't have to do it perfectly. And it's okay to have a blip, because a blip isn't a failure, as long as you just learn from it, you know, what's the thinking behind the blip. And when you see this always, you know, just something that you can learn from, you keep on building up that awareness and that understanding about all your thinking styles and your limiting beliefs, like, you know, social anxiety and self-esteem.
Yeah, I think Sarah explained it very well in terms of, it's almost that getting over their emetophobia, excuse me, is a byproduct of raising the self-esteem, lowering the social anxiety, creating... this is a test. Excuse me. Creating an internal locus of control. We hardly talk about being sick or metaphor, the whole programme. It's almost irrelevant. When you have an internal locus of control and your self-esteem is high and your social anxiety is low, you can no longer be a perfectionist. If you have an internal locus of control, you can no longer be obsessive. At that moment, you cease to be an emetophobe. The emetophobia is a symptom of the thinking and beliefs, not the other way around. You know, ostensibly, it's a fear of being out of control. Any other questions?
Can you tell us who you did tell about your phobia? And also, when you were sick, how long into the programme were you sick yourself? Can you remember?
Now, as a metaphor, I could tell you the day, where I was, the time, because that's how obsessive I was. But actually, thinking about now, I
don't know for sure how long into the sessions it was. I think it might have even been after I'd completed it.
I think it was.
To the point where I was that nauseous with it, I think it was some winter bug thing going around, that I tried to make myself sick, which, gosh, I mean, that just would be beyond anything I would ever have done. Sorry, what was the other question?
Yeah, who you told?
Yeah, funnily enough, I told an ex-partner of mine, actually. So... And he was just in disbelief, the fact that he didn't realise I had it. Because, again, you know, I sort of disguised it as well as I could. But he did, once he knew, he then did remember certain things that used to happen, where I would hide from him if I was ill, or I'd never go near him if he was ill. And he'd never heard of the phobia either.
How long were you in that relationship?
About 4 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a lot of
Yeah. He just thought I just found it uncomfortable and just unpleasant, like I guess most people do, really. So, but.
What made you decide to try this program, given that you thought you were going to have to live this with this for your, you know, whole yeah. life? Why did you try this?
I think the turning point for me was I've lived in London now for about 3 years. So again, moving to London was another way of me trying to deal with it, be out there in crowded places, try and put myself in situations, but it was still always there. I just dealt with it. And then last year, I think I just found myself in a really good place. I was happy in my job, happy in myself, but there was just this one thing, the emetophobia, that just had this hold on me.
Why Cara?
Just from reading the reviews on her website, found her, yeah, and, well, found the book, I researched the book first, and then found Cara, and just, I don't know, maybe it was just that connection. I thought, yeah, she's the lady I want to see.
So how did you find the book? Did you go online?
Yes.
And Googled it?
I did. And just, yeah, did a lot of research, read reviews and everything, and just thought, yeah, this is the book. This will change my life. And it was just having that belief, really, that I want to do this.
I think credit to Sarah for putting so much effort in. You know, people who do give 100% will get better.
Yeah, that is so important with Thrive. It is a training programme. It's not where you just go in and sit down next to a therapist and they hold your hand and go, yeah, it's okay, I'll make you better now. You know, I'll take it all away. It's not. You have to put the hard work in, and I did. But I loved it. Every time I left Cara, I couldn't wait to get back home and get back into the book again, and I just lived and breathed it. Used to wake up looking forward to getting into it. And so I've really enjoyed doing the programme, and the fact that it's cured me and I can sit here and talk about it is just it is amazing. And I just can't thank Rob and Cara enough as well.
Well, you could try. Anything else? Sorry.
So your life now, you said before that you eating out was difficult and all those things. So tell us now how much your life has changed.
Food-wise, I don't check sell-by dates. Well, okay, I might look at them for certain things, but I'm not obsessing about it. I don't mind flicking over, and if there's a hospital programme on, that doesn't bother me. That's something else I would avoid watching. I sit on the tube or public transport now, and I'm not seeking out who might be ill. All these things I've processed on my daily lists of that. Yeah, I'm getting better. Gosh, there's so many things.
Are you able to eat that more?
Yeah, yeah. And I just can't wait. The one thing I want to try now, actually, and maybe we could have this for lunch, Rob, is to try something like oysters. I've never tried them. They don't look particularly nice.
Yeah, you're on your own. Yeah.
But it sounds crazy, but it's one dish I've always wanted to try, but just been so scared that... I don't. Oh, I just want to try them. Now that would be, yeah. I'm on the lookout. I was hoping there'd be some single men here, but yeah. See if you know any eligible single guys.
They'll be queuing up, Sarah. Don't worry, they'll be queuing up. Anyone else? Anything else? Any other questions? This is. Can I just say that actually. I really hadn't met Sarah for today, and we haven't been scouring the country to find the one person. You know, we have dozens, if not hundreds, of people like Sarah. This is typical of an emetophobe that's been through the programme. Typical.
In the pack that we've got for you as well, there is Sarah's story. There are three other ladies in there as well who have equally got, I think, important stories, but very similar to Sarah, actually, sort of couldn't remember a time when they weren't emetophobic and they had a problem. Mm-hmm. So I think hopefully you'll find that interesting.
I think... one more question.
Yeah, just...
Did you mention when you put a name to it yourself, when you kind of went, this is what it's about? Did you have an aha moment for... I know you said you were misdiagnosed with an eating disorder, but when did you realise as a person that was the key thing?
I always knew it was there. I think even whenever I did find the name emetophobia, that didn't really matter to me that it had a special name. Mm. It was still, to me, a massive fear of being sick. So I think if you probably ask any emetophobe, they'd probably agree that the name of it doesn't really make any difference. It's the fear.
And in conjunction with that, do you feel that, because I'm very different, obviously, with my daughter, I'm very open about it, so I will say, Kitty's vomit phobic. So she's got this word. Do you think I perpetuate something in that?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Which I thought could be the case, but then equally you kind of...
Well, it's really, really, really difficult not to perpetuate or collude. I mean, you saw the faces. You really have to go out of your way to challenge everything she says. You know, a belief system is like a brick wall, and every brick is adding to the size of that brick wall. So you need to take that apart brick by brick by brick. So every day, we'll have a chat about it afterwards, but every day you want to challenge those beliefs. The moment you even agree and accept it, you're kind of colluding with her belief that it's not going to get better. Inadvertently, it's a no-win situation unless you're very, very clever about it. I've got a saying which is a little bit tongue-in-cheek.
It's kind of an effort to normalise it, really, as
Absolutely.
Much as anything, from my point of view, and not to dig it underground and to make people aware that that's why certain behaviours are around within this, because it affects so many areas of social.
But by normalising it, the person puts less effort into getting over it.
Yeah,
so it's a double-edged sword. It's difficult. I'm not saying it's easy. It's difficult. But doing it the right way, it's really predictable that people will get over their emetophobia if they go through this book.
Yeah.
It's that predictable. Yes.
Sorry, I'd love to talk. Sorry.
Clearly the social anxiety's gone,
I'm on a roll now.
Okay.
I'm just so passionate about it. Because obviously you're a mum and your daughter suffers with this, it is imperative that, as Rob says, that parents do get involved. Because my mum, I'm not saying that's where it stemmed from, I know we don't talk about triggers and things, but I even look at my mum now and she doesn't panic around when she's around sick, but there is definitely an issue there. And
I know I have as well, I know that there's definitely part of
it. Yeah,
And I remember her reactions to people being sick, or if someone was drunk and they were sick, she would say things, oh, it's disgusting, and, you know, how horrible. So that's definitely an important part to get the parents involved. Yeah. I wished I'd had that all those years ago. But it doesn't matter now. I'll be training my mum next.
It's not. I said to people, it's, you know, when I speak to mums or dads, I say, look, it's not about blaming you. We're not saying that it's any way, shape, your fault, but you are the best person to train them out of it. You get far more access than the Thrive consultant would get, and just little surreptitious tweaks in your behaviour. You don't even need to tell her that you've read the book, but if you just tweak your behaviour and your responses to her, you could train her out of that within 4 or 6 weeks, just by tweaking your behaviour to her. Yeah, definitely. Are we all done? Lovely. In that case, ladies, gentlemen, thank you very, very much for coming. You do have a pack. I'm very happy to answer any emails or questions you've got at a later date. Thank you for coming. Thanks very much indeed. Thank you. And thank you to my lovely panel and Sarah, who will happily talk on for hours about it, I'm sure.